Okay, I guess we can start. Good morning, good afternoon, greetings of the day. We'll start now with our webinar. Before we come to the seminar itself, just a few boundary conditions. You might have noticed that your mics are muted. And yeah, you cannot unmute them yourself. At least it should be like that. But it's WebEx after all, so make sure that your microphone is muted. If you have any questions, we'd like to ask you to post them in the chat. We will collect them and try to answer them at the end of this seminar. So if you want to chat, you can send a message to all of us, or to Mathias Merten, DYNAmore GmbH, or to Thomas Klöppel, DYNAmore, and we will try to answer them at the end of the presentation. Within this chat, you will find a link to a survey at the end. We will post it, and then you can click there if you like. It would be great. It would be great help for us, and leave some feedback. So having that said, I think we can now really start. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Thomas Klöppel. You see my picture here on the bottom left. I've been with DYNAmore for 9 years now. I work as a developer for LS-DYNAr. I'm the lead developer for the thermal part, but I'm also to blame for some of the materials in LS-DYNAr. And two of those will be introduced today. I'm not completely blamed for 244. It's older than me, but some of the later developments have been implemented by myself. So now I'd like to hand over to Mathias, who will start with this seminar and moderate the first block.
So hello, everyone. My name is Mathias Merten. I'm with DYNAmore since 5 years now, I think. I'm a project engineer and mainly for process and forming simulation. And I see these phase transformation simulation with LS-DYNAr, some kind of my, I'll not call it hobby, but my special field of interest, so to say. And today, together with Thomas, I would like to present you some blueprints and discuss with you how to transfer these phase transformation data from MUT 244 to MUT 54. So, and on the right, you can see a picture of me. Maybe it's not that up to date, but I think you still have a picture of mine. So what's the schedule for today? I will start with a more or less short motivation on the topic of phase transformation within LS-DYNAr, and then hand over to Thomas, who will introduce both of his material laws, the 244 and the 254. And at the end, I will take back control to do the parameter identification for one phase evolution in MUT 254 based on MUT 244. So that's the plan for today. Let's start with the motivation. And we decide for the motivation to follow a bit the process chain of a car manufacturer. So it will start with a single part, which has to be produced, and will then go to the assembly line and then to the dryer oven. And after this dryer oven, after the paint shop, you have the car body structure more or less ready. And if you think on the materials which are used in a modern car, you may have seen these pictures on the right hand, which are often referred as steel bananas due to this characteristical shape of these entries in this diagram. Here you can see several bubbles for several steels with different microstructures and their characteristic material properties, which are most important for the, let's say, for the crash guys. There is the elongation at fracture or tooth fracture and the tensile strength. And there are different materials available. You may have heard about these interstitial free steels, about the back hardening steels, the microalloyed steels, dual phase and complex phase steels. And for the highest or for the most strength, you have may heard about these press hardening steels, or in the past, it was mainly the 22 MNB5. And we have this picture in our seminar slides, but we should update it with the latter one, because this one is from 2012, and this one is, I think I took it last week from the World Auto Steel. And you have seen a huge development in the strength range of the steels. So when we here went to 1400 megapascal, we now are up to 2000 megapascal within a decade. This is amazing, I would say. And also we have different steels which are not on that banana, and because they activate more deformation mechanisms inside the material, and therefore they leave this characteristic line you have here. And today we are focusing a bit on these press hardening steels, because to achieve this highest strength here, you need to give the part producer some more tasks. Classically, in cold forming, the material supplier is defining the properties of his steels in his, for example, in his steel plant. The same is true for the aluminum and for other metals. And then the part producer is defining the geometry. But with press hardening, the part producer is also responsible for the mechanical properties, for the microstructure. And this leads to several tasks or challenges. But in general, in a steel plant, and also in press hardening, the environment is more or less controlled. So you know which temperature fields you can expect, or which temperature curves you can expect inside your process. And that leads to our statement here, relatively well-known and well-controlled environment. So a temperature is always not that good to control, because it's difficult to measure it, but it's relatively well-known. You do every time the same, so it's more or less well-known. So which options you may have for this press hardening? There are several processes available, and even more were developed in the past and still under development, like tailored press hardening with tailored properties inside the part. But assuming you want to create a full press hardened part, you have three options. The first one is the indirect press hardening, where you create the geometry with classical cold forming, and then go to an austenitization oven, and finally do the quenching. So you define the geometry, and then you heat it up and define then the microstructure, and have then the highest strength inside the material. This indirect press hardening, called PHS Ultraform, is one variant of this top one, but still an indirect process. Indirect because the forming process and the microstructure definition are some kind of uncoupled. In the direct press hardening, and I would assume that today most of the press hardening parts are produced by this direct press hardening, you have forming and quenching combined. So you are forming the austen, the blank within the fully austenitic state. And during the quenching inside the forming tool, you create the microstructure. So this is meant with these well-known environment, so to say, because you have these cooling rates every time, you know with which material state you are starting, and you really know what your material is doing. This is especially true for the 22 MMB5, where many literature data is available, and I would say it's one of the best described steel you can find today in a car. So after you have produced the single part, usually this is not a car, so you need to join them together to more or less complex assemblies and sub-assemblies, and usually this is done by welding. And the welding process itself, compared to the other process, is a bit uncontrolled, speaking with respect to the temperature curves. So depending on the position of your point where you are, relative to the welding point, you can see different temperature profiles. There is many different temperatures you can see with different intensities and different times. The video on the right shows this for a build-up welding. You see each of these weld lines added to the part, and each is connected with some heat input and with these temperatures. So there are on different parts inside the part, there are multiple reheatings possible. So you undergo complex phase transformations because you have every possible or thinkable temperature profile inside this. This is the same issue with 3D printing. You can interpret this process shown here as some kind of 3D printing for metals, and they have the same problem with the temperature profile, changing the microstructure and changing it in a more or less, let's say, arbitrary way, because it's uncontrolled. You cannot influence it that much. This leads to our statement, we have uncontrolled phase transformations. And yeah, after these parts are welded together and the whole structure is defined, the car gets painted in the paint shop. And in the paint shop, you have these different baths where you can apply the color and the protection for corrosion, against corrosion. And after this, there is a dryer oven, typically up to 200 degrees Celsius as temperature. And you can imagine that not each point of your car reaches the same maximum temperature or sees the same temperature time profile. And this temperature time profile can lead to different bake hardening effects. So many materials are designed to have such a bake hardening effect, so that the heat or the temperature inside the oven will lead to an increase in the strength. If you remember the first slide, there was a steel grade called bake hardening steels. This is why they are called in that way, because during this process, they are increasing their strength by approximately 50 megapascals, sometimes up to 100 megapascals. And for aluminum, this process step is, or for some aluminum alloys, this process step is crucial. And you can see this here on this picture. It is taken from a speech on our conference, where you can see the final strength of an aluminum alloy, depending on the time spent at 180 degrees Celsius, depending on different pre-strain levels. So depending on your temperature profile you see with a B pillar, you can achieve different properties inside your part, depending in this case on the oven. So the whole process chain will lead to locally distributed material properties, and you may have the task as engineer to calculate with these properties, to design the process, to check if the process makes, or if maybe the assumptions done by the crashing department are wrong, and so on. And therefore you need special material models to capture these evolutions of the properties. And as they are mainly caused by these microstructural changes, you may need MAT 254 for 40, no, 54 for it, sorry. So, and today we would like to present you how you can make this material work for you in case of phase transformations. And for that, we used our well-known MAT 244 as a virtual experiment. So we will do some tests, or we have already done these tests with MAT 244, and we have shown this before in 2019 on our conference in a workshop. And the tests were conducted with single elements, because what is happening in the microstructure is not size dependent of the model. It's just a function of the temperature. And we start with from 1500 Kelvin, so with a fully austenitic microstructure, and we quenched it rapidly to a holding temperature and hold it at this holding temperature and wait some time. So we are doing these isothermal TTT diagrams with these material cards, which is already which is given. And we had 7 elements in the ferrite formation window and 7 elements in the perlite formation window. And today we will focus on this ferrite formation due to timing reasons, but we will mention these perlite formation too. So what we will do in this webinar is based on that we know what we want to describe. We already know what is happening by this material in this process. So if you want to apply that blueprint on another process and on another material, you may first need to know this point, what you want to describe and what you need to describe. And this can, in a real world problem or in another problem, be a difficult task to identify what you need to describe to get these process dependent properties or these phase distributions. So for us, we can thankfully do these virtual experiments because we have everything inside this 244 needed for it. And to sum up, what we discussed today is a what if scenario. So what if we have this experimental data available, and what if we already know what we need to do, how to proceed with that? And therefore, Thomas will now shortly introduce our virtual laboratory with the material models which we use for this.
Yes. So first of all, I'd like to give you a short overview about the material model in terms of the mechanical behavior. Then the focus is clearly on a phase transformation algorithm, because we want to translate the phase transformations from 244 to 250. And then I will talk about the experimental results. Experimental results means this numerical experiment that Mathias has just shown with the 15 or 7 different elements, single element tests. So, what we have is a material, and we always have to keep that in mind, that is tailored for hot stamping and press hardening processes, and mainly for the indirect press hardening, I'd say. It accounts for the decomposition of the austenitic phase into the other microstructures like ferrite, perlite, bainite, and Merten. And that's it. So we always have this, at maximum, this 5 different microstructures. And the mechanical side, this means we have a very relatively simple material behavior. So it's elastic plastic with a J2 elasticity model. We have temperature and strain rate dependence, yes. Also, we added transformation induced strains and plasticity and the thermal expansion, but all there is based on a mixture, rule of mixture, where we take as input, so to say, the phase fractions and the respective quantity of the phase, that is an input usually, and then we sum it up, weighted by the current phase fraction to get the overall mechanical property, say, for example, the elasticity, the Young's modulus. So you take the Young's moduli from the single phases, and then you apply this rule of mixtures to get the overall Young's modulus. The good thing about this material is the user input. So what you can do in terms of the phase transformation is that you do not have to worry about what's happening on the microstructure. The material does it for you. It expects you to input the alloying elements in mass percent, so the chemical composition of the metal. Also some latent heat, if you want to account for latent heat for the phase change reaction, which you can measure, for example, you can measure it. Expects activation energies for the phase transformations, something like initial grain size, the yield curves for the individual phases, additionally also the elastic moduli, and the coefficients of thermal expansion. So and what you get out of it is it will do calculate the phase transformation. The phase transformation constants are calculated based on this chemical composition. And then when you apply a certain temperature field, temperature stress field, you get as an answer the current phase fractions of the different phases, a Vickers hardness estimate, and also the resulting yield strength. And what you see here is you can, with that, calculate such a CCT diagram, numerically. Some more details on the phase transformation. It's based on the work of Paul Åkerström from Sweden, so from Luleå. He implemented this material first as a user material, I think, and then handed it over to the LSTC for implementation at the time. And this model is actually taking other literature models and combining them. I'll show you on the next slide what that means. So you also have some estimate heuristic formula for the starting temperatures for the transformations. You see, for example, you get them on the D3HSP file, the message files will tell you, okay, these are the starting temperatures I calculated. That's where we will start the phase transformation. If you cool down, for example, after 1110 Kelvin, if you fall below this temperature, the ferrite will start. It will end as soon as the perlite transformation starts, and so on and so forth. And you can also define for some of these algorithms or some of these reactions, you can define a window where they overlap. It's called overbleeding in the input. So if you have a look at the manual and you see something like an overbleeding window, this means this is what it is, this overlap between the end temperature of the perlite as compared to the start temperature of the beta. You can also define the start temperatures individually, and you can also define them differently than for heating and cooling, which of course makes sense. If you want to reheat, then the temperature where the austenite is formed is of course higher than the starting temperature for the austenite decomposition. A bit more, still further details. I said that the work of Åkerström is actually a summary or a composition of different models, and based on the Kirkcaldy and Vanugopalan and by what for the diffusion control phase changes, it's basically what kind of heuristic formula is used for the starting temperatures and also for some scaling factors. And for that, we can model the whole decomposition with a rate equation, so these evolution equations, in this ghost fraction, capital X. And ghost fraction means that it's a normalized fraction for the respective phase. Here I have to say X1 is always austenite, X2 is then the ferrite, X3 is perlite, and X4 is bainite, X5 will then be the martensitic phase fraction. A ghost fraction means you divide it, you normalize it with an equilibrium phase fraction for the respective temperature. And this normalization is, of course, done with these true fractions, and the true phase fractions have to sum up to one, that's clear. And the ghost fractions are always one if you have a fully full transformation. So let's dig into these equations. You see it is a multiplicative composition of four terms usually. The first defines a grain size dependence, and in all cases it's done with this potential equation. So you have the G, the current grain size is the power for the function. You have a temperature dependence for sure. Here it looks like that. So here is the activation term with the activation energy, but you also have a power term always with respect to the starting temperature. You have the current phase concentration plays a role. That's for sure. Otherwise, you wouldn't have an evolution equation. So this is the part where it gets a differential equation. So here, it has this form that is based on Lort, for example. So you have these power equations where you have the current phase to the power of the phase itself in this sense. And for bayonet, you also have this term here, this exponential equation. So the CR 2 and 3 will be zero. So then this denominator vanishes. I just wanted to show because then we can compare it what we have in 254. I want to give you these formulas. You never have to do anything with that when you use the material for sure, but it's sometimes nice to know what's going on underneath. And then you have a term, a scaling factor with respect to chemical composition that's somewhere, as I said, heuristic formula, somewhere hidden, taken from the papers, strange formulas, strange powers and whatever. But at the end of the day, these are done to calibrate the model from certain experimental data. Merten's static formation is fairly standard. I think that's still state of the art. It's Kirstein Marburger. It's diffusionless. So this is only a function of the temperature. So you do not have any rate equation, no evolution. It's just depending on the current temperature and also on the initial values when the transformation starts. So then you have the austenite phase fraction, and then you have only this exponential function for the temperature. And here you have the Kirstein-Marburger factor, which defines how fast the phase transformation will actually proceed with respect to temperature. And these are results for our experimental data. So what you see here is that we have, I think, seven results for the ferrite concentration, for the ferrite transformation, always with 10K difference. And what you see, first thing to see the trend that the cooler it gets, if you quench it to a lower temperature, that means you have a faster phase transformation, but also you have higher equilibrium concentrations for the ferrite. That's what comes out of these equations I've shown before. And you see also the form does not change because the equation does not change qualitatively with the temperature. It's just that this FT changes a bit. So you have always this temperature difference, T start minus T in there somehow, and this accelerates your phase transformation, but it does not change the slope. So if this is more or less just a scaling down, and also a scaling with respect to the time. When you have a look at Perlet, you see that here there is no such thing as equilibrium formulations for this particular phase. That's just not in material 244. So if you quench it directly into the Perlet range, and leave it there, and it will always try to form 100% Perlet. And you see that again, it's always has this asymptotic behavior towards the one, and only a scaling with respect to the temperature. So it just lower temperature accelerate the transformation. So I already said that this material is tailored for hot stamping. And it has basic welding functionality implemented. That's something we added when we started with welding simulations. So the one you saw in the motivation slide. but we already saw that it has only very limited capability for the heating phases, and almost nothing for the tempering. Tempering is only something in this model for the viscous hardness, but not for the phase transformation. So you cannot temper your material. This is the process limitation. So what you have to say is, if you want to do anything else than hot stamping or press hardening, this is probably not the best material to use. And there's another field of limitations. It's only really feasible for 22 MnB5 steel alloys. If you leave this range or this group of materials, then you probably end up with some non-physical answers. It's because of this heuristic formulas for start and temperatures, but also for the phase transformation parameters. You cannot really expect them to be feasible if you have a chemical composition that is away from a 22 MnB5. The other thing is that it's only restricted to 5 phases. You can leave some of the phases out, yes, but if you want to do like tempered martensite, tempered bionite or something like that, or you want to, I don't know, have some molten phase for welding, then this material is not the right one for you. And that's what we noticed when we wanted to do welding simulation here. That's the for me or for the implementation of the new material. That was the main motivation. We need something else. We need a material that is a bit more general. And we came up with 254. It's called Mat Generalized Phase Change. And I also will give you now an overview about the properties, basic properties, and some elaborate properties, not the full range, of course, that would exceed this Express seminar by far. And I want to focus again on the phase change model, and only on the part that we need to model something that we have seen for the 244. We want to reproduce it or have a bit better data for it, basically, with this new material. So let's start. Basic features, what's the main difference? Now we are not restricted to 24, to 5 phases, but to 24 phases. I know that's quite a lot, but and you usually don't need it, but you could use them. That's the potential of this material. And with these 24 phases, you can define, if you like, all the possible phase change scenarios between them. So that adds up to 552, and probably you never want to do that. And it's also not physical. Of course, there is never a phase transformation between all the different phases. Some can just not be transformed into the other directly. But it can do phase change modeling for heating, cooling, and also for temperature window, where just, you know, if you are in this window, this will happen no matter if you cool or heat it up. And we have some phase change models already implemented. So I think there are 9 models right now. And as a user, you can just choose from those phase change models. And it's easy, very, very easy to update it. If you say, okay, I have material blah, 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 and we need a 10th phase change model, and here's the paper that it shows it's best and it can do whatever is needed, then we could easily add it to this material. So the material is very flexible in a sense of the phase transformation, what kind of phase transformation you can apply, but it's also flexible in terms of further updating this scenario. The basic mechanical features are exactly the same as before. It's just not that you sum up to 5, now you sum up to 24, but most mechanical quantities are still based on this rule of mixtures. And you can also define a a scaling factor with respect to the temperature for this mixture rule, but this is more like an experimental feature. It hasn't been tested very well by our users, so this is not really recommended. So the standard would be this rule of mixtures as you see here. Let's talk about some elaborate features. Yes, there is a latent heat algorithm, but that again is the same as 244. But there is also the possibility to see as a user additional post-processing data. I don't want to go into details, but there's a parameter called post V, and you can tell, okay, I'd like to see, for example, the thermal strain tensor, plastic strain tensor, or equivalent strains. And then the code will calculate these values, which are not needed as standard history. So the code does not need it for the computation itself. It's just calculated for you as user for post-processing. And it will actually add those to the here to the list of history variables, and it will try to get them relatively on top. So it's not completely on top, but here these are also values you usually need as user. But then it will write them in this block here. These are the post-processing history data. Asked for by the user with this post V parameter. And if you don't activate this feature, then this block is so to say empty, and we continue with plastic here after current temperature, we continue with plastic strains. But if you ask for additional parameters, then they will be written into this block. And there's another user-defined block you see here, so-called user-defined histories. And user-defined histories is even much more flexible. Here we are referred to a defined function keyword. I hope you know it from Dyna. Defined function means that you can give an algebraic expression, whatever you like, trigonometric functions, exponential functions, whatever, on certain values. And you will see that as a history. So the input is, for example, time, user-defined histories, all of those. So I think you can have up to 8 histories. You see them, you can use them, you can do some kind of calculation with those and update it. You get the phase concentrations, the current temperature, the current peak temperature, the current temperature rate, some stress state, plastic strain data, for example, and whatnot. For example, you could use that to calculate a maximum strain rate. Temperature rate, so to say. So you get the temperature rate, you compare it to your history, user history number one, and if it's larger, then you store it as history number one. And if it's lower, then you leave it with history number, the old history number, user history number one. And then at the end of the day, you get the maximum temperature rate written into this function. I don't know if you need it, but that's one possibility. I think the motivation for that is that you can implement a Pickers-Harness calculation on your own, because there are quite a few available in literature. They are mostly based on some experimental results or heuristic functions, and you can calculate them there yourself to get an estimate on the Pickers-Harness. I couldn't implement all of those into the model. I think this user history feature provides a fairly nice way of doing such a thing. And we also have some kind that's called enhanced annealing, where you can reset the plastic strains depending on time and temperature, and you can even do it with a evolution equation if you like. So that's the material input. It's a bit complicated and it's really overwhelming at the beginning. I think if you have a look at the manual, you see it will have, I think, 10 pages or so only on this material right now, because of all the remarks and where we try to give the formulas and the features, describe them in some detail. But what you have to know is basically you define the number of phases here, you give some tabular data for the Young's modulus, Poisson's ratio, the initial mixture, that's what you have to do. Here, this card is basically the annealing, so the reset of plastic strain. The 2A card would be the enhanced annealing if you activate it. And then parts 3, 4, and 5 are mostly on phase transformations. And we will talk now in the following slide only on about card 3 and 4. But you can also define here, there's the latent heat, for example. Here's the phase transformation induced strains. You also see here the post V parameter I talked about, the number of user histories, and so on and so forth. And here, card 6, 7, and 8 are just the load curves defining, or tables defining the yield curves, the flow curves for the individual phases, temperature and strain rate, depending if you like. So let's concentrate only on the phase transformation for now. The idea was that we have this material that is fairly general. So this means we cannot base the whole phase transformation on chemical composition, but we need the user to give the parameterization, so the phase transformation parameters directly. And here we decided to have it in a matrix-like structure, which at the beginning is a bit, sounds a bit strange, or if you see it now, I think, but it's fairly clear, or it makes it, it's consistent, let's say. So first of all, you have to define, for all of these parameters, you have to define such matrices where you have the from phase for each line and the to phase on the columns. So you have always, this is parameter 2, 1, this is the parameter 1, 2, and so on and so forth. So the DYNA will provide the defined table keyword for that. So the first parameter would be the law itself. So you can say, okay, from phase 1 to phase 2, whatever it is, there is no hard coding of the phases to a number or a physical meaning. So from phase 1 to phase 2, I'd like to have law, blah, blah. And I'll show you in a second what this law could be. And so you define the different, this is what you choose from the list of available phase transformation laws. And of course, if you leave it blank, so you, for example, the law 3, 2 is 0, so you do not input anything, then this transformation is not accounted for in the simulation. So it would be, for example, the transformation from perlit to ferrite, not possible. So here you will have a 0. The same is true for the start and end temperature, so they are not calculated anymore, but we expect you to input those. So this is just a table containing temperatures, temperature data in Kelvin, of course. Start and end temperature for two parameters. And when we have transformation constant, like the Quistin-Marburger model, if you remember, we had this Quistin-Marburger factor alpha, this is a scalar data, would also be given in such a form. Now, there is one further complication. For some of the parameters, or most of the parameters, are temperature dependent. So now we expect load curve input. So you still have the same matrix structure, but now you give here load curve IDs. And if you're familiar with it, this means that you have a defined table 3D in DYNA. So this would be a table 3D, and the value in the table would then be a load curve ID. And here you can have load curves defining a function of temperature or of temperature rate, depending on what you actually have. So the meaning of these parameters depend on the transformation law, and I will show you now what kind of laws there are. So this is the full list. We have a Quistin-Marburger, of course. Then we have this JMAC approach, generalized Johnson-Miller Avramikov-Mogorov model. We have the orchestra model for cooling. So it's the same as 244, it's just to compare the models. We have the number 4, which is the Audi model. That's the model that has been used for heating. or re-austenitization in 244. And then we have some models, just to mention, for titanium. And if you're interested in that, have a look at the ESOFOAM conferences this year or last year. And there we have papers presenting the implementation for titanium. But today we want to concentrate only on the models for the steel alloys 22 MnB5. So let's have a look. So if you want to reproduce 244 exactly, you see now we have only five faces. The one would be austenite, the second one would be ferrite, the third perlite, the fourth bayonet, and the fifth monzitic face fraction. And in terms of the transformation models, you would have the Arquestre model. So this is the ones I just showed a couple of minutes ago for the austenitic decomposition. And then you have the Kustin Marburger for Merten side formation. And for re-austenitization, we haven't talked about that, it's if you would have body, and this minus means this is a model that's to be used for heating, and the positive entries mean this is a phase transformation model to be used for cooling. What we would say, the best practice is not to go with 3, 4, and 1, but only with 2 and 1. So JMAC for the phase transformation for cooling as well as for heating. So I guess I have to speed up a little. So let's go to the Kustin Marburger. It's the same model as before. And when we run a constant cooling simulation, for example, you see that the you get this exponential form, of course, and with increasing alpha with the Marburger factor, it would actually accelerate your transformation. Yeah, it's already can already be seen in the formula. And you only have one parameter, is this first one for the alpha. It's getting a bit more complicated for the JMAC, and here you see the integral form of it. What you can often find in literature, if you Google JMAC, you will probably end up with something like that. Here at the beginning, this three, or these two terms, or whatever you think, these are the transformation potential, so to say, what you can reach. It's the equilibrium concentration of the formed phases and the initial concentration of the formed and the source phase. And then you have this exponential asymptotic behavior towards this potential. Here we have an example. If you play around, I will show this in more detail on the next slide. So here you see what happens if you change the N parameter. Here you see what happens when you change the relaxation time tau here for the exponential increase. And of course, you have the equilibrium concentration you can play around with. This is the integral form, as I said. That's the one you find in literature, but that's not the one we can use in Alice, because what we need is an differential equation. I know there are other approaches to deal with non-isothermal cases, but what we decided to do is to reform the equation into an evolution equation. So divided the whole thing by dt, then played around, you have to play around a bit with it. And at the end of the day, what you see, you get this ordinary differential equation. We don't have to talk about it, but that's the one that is actually implemented. The only thing I'd like to mention here is that we also have this accelerating or decelerating parameter with respect to plastic strains. You can add, you can also have some, parameters where you can scale the whole thing with respect to temperature rate. So this is just modification factors. You hopefully don't need those, but sometimes you do. And here you see the influence of the parameters again. So first of all, that's what the power of the exponential equation is n. If you change it, what you see here, it really changes the qualitative behavior of your foil's concentration formation. So from, I think we started with 0.5, we get more or less this slope here, the red one. And if you increase the N to, I think, maximum 4 in our case, get this double L or this S kind of slope with a much smoother beginning of the transformation, symmetric approach. This would be 1/E, I think, because then you can read the relaxation time, because then you have e to the power of -1, and then it doesn't matter what the n is. But you can also, of course, change this equilibrium concentration, and the result is as expected. It doesn't change anything in terms of the speed of the transformation. It doesn't change the slope of the transformation. It just scales the whole thing up and down. And last but not least, we have the relaxation time. So this is the characteristic time of your transformation. What you see here, if you increase it, of course, the whole transformation becomes slower, and you scale it, so to say, down respect to the time. So with that, I'd like to hand over to Mathias again, and Mathias will now show how to combine the results I've shown for 244 and the phase transformations I've shown in 254. Mathias, I'm sorry, I took a bit longer than I expected.
I think that is fine, Thomas. I also took a bit longer in the introduction, but I think that topic requires a bit more time. So thank you, Thomas. One question, can you hear me? Hopefully.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. Yeah, that was always a bit strange to talk alone in a computer and not getting any response. Still not familiar with that. Now I would like to show you how to practically identify parameter. To practically identify the parameters for 254 based on 244. And I first will talk about this equilibrium concentration. I will then give an overview on what we call direct approach and graphical approach. And then with both approaches, I will discuss the creation of this N and this relaxation time. So if we take a look on these virtual experiments, we have seen these pictures before for ferrite. We can easily guess or take the equilibrium concentration from that, because the equilibrium concentration is this asymptotic value we are reaching with each temperature. So if you draw a line here horizontally, you can easily take these values out of this diagram. So that was rather simple, so to say. And one thing to mention, if we take a look on the real data we have available after our experiments, so the data points, so to say, we see here which points we have available. So each point represents one experiment. So you have a time, or you have a temperature, and you have a certain holding time. And at this point, you make a measurement. At this point, you make a measurement. So here, due to the fact that we work with a computer, we have a very high resolution of experimental data. In a real world problem, think about dielometric length measurement or whatever, you may not have this high density. So this is one thing to keep in mind. So I will stay to this, let's say, true point data, because this is what we have available. And usually to get these physical experiments for these points, this is not that trivial. This is really difficult, and difficult means often quite expensive. So depending on your time you have for your transformation, you can do it in an oven, but if you have a very fast transformation, a classical heat treatment oven is not enough. Maybe a Klöppel machine would be okay, but maybe you need differentials, a DSC differential, scanning calorimetry. It's a difficult word, sorry for it. This is really difficult to get these real test data. But thankfully, the 22 MMB5 has been investigated by many, many students and many, many, and maybe many more PhD students. We have this data already available. So, yeah. So based on our virtual experiment, we can get these data. So that was rather simple. So let's talk about this direct and graphical approach. So therefore, I would like to take this integral form because it's, I would say it's much more easy to see things with it. First step, we need to rearrange this equation to get something we called relative reaction coordinate. There are several other names available for it, transformation coordinate, hardening degree, but names doesn't matter that much. So the important thing is that you have here a phi, and this ranges from 0 to 1, and this follows this equation. And this is describing your degree of the transformation. So when it does not start yet, this one will be 0, and if it's finished, it will be 1. And between the 0 and the 1, you have this double S shape, which is typically for this JMAC approach. In our case, we can stick to the metallurgical phases because we already have identified them, or someone else did it for us. But what you also often find in literature is some phenomenological approach for it. And they do nearly the same, but they scale it with a property. So P stands for an arbitrary property. I have seen it for, well, I did it myself for hardness and tensile and yield strength. And I measure a strength after a certain isothermal time temperature procedure, because this equation is valid for isothermal temperatures, and then scale it between a minimum and a maximum property. And with that, you can calculate this transformation degree, and then the whole blueprint applies on that one. So this is often for the phenomenological approach. And I've seen it also in literature for aluminum as the electromagnetic values of several aluminum alloys also depend on the precipitation state, and the precipitations also often follow this equation. So you measure, for example, the resistivity, and then you know your amount of precipitations. And yeah, so this is more or less equivalent. Okay, so we now have this equation. Phi is something with an exponent. We can rearrange it with a logarithm or with two logarithms, and then we got a linear equation. And in this linear equation, we have two unknowns. And you may remember your math course at school. If you have two unknowns, you need 2 points to calculate the unknowns. And this is why we call it direct approach, because for 1 point, we have this lambda one associated with a T1 at a temperature, for a given temperature. So the temperature is kept fixed. And we have the same for another point. And then we can rearrange the formulas to the N and to the tau. And we then can directly calculate these temperature-depending parameters based on these both points, 1 and 2. So this is direct calculation. That's why we name it direct approach. Different thing, but similar, is the graphical approach. Therefore, I suggest you to introduce or to change this relaxation time term to a K from T. And if you enter it, you see a more common formulation of the JMAC approach with this pre-exponential factor, which is time dependent. And if you do so, you can get a, I think, more beautiful linear equation, because you now have an constant for temperature, and you have an slope, and you have an x-coordinate. So this is a linear equation, right? So what we can do is we can plot it, and if we plotted it, we can simply get the parameters n as the slope, and the k, or the ln of k, as the intersection with the ordinate. So this is also rather simple. You will see it soon. One note for this k of t. In literature, or generally, this is often described with an Arrhenius-like approach. And then you have these k0, which is a constant, temperature independent, and this activation energy. So you may remember this term. You find it quite often in phase transformation kinetics. So as LS-Dyna requires the tau, we don't need to think about this one, but you can easily recalculate it if you know these formulas. So I'm sorry for this, many formulas, but let's apply this. It's rather simple, if you know. And so let's do the direct approach for the ferrite transformation. Please remember, we have this lambda, which is connected to this reaction coordinate. And we have chosen values for 10 and 90% of the transformation to be done. It is really difficult to identify the start of a phase transformation. I mean, in finite element simulation, we have nodal values, we have elements. This is quite good. But in reality, there are thousands of molecules connected with it, or atoms connected, and there is a lot of statistics playing in. And so it's more a rule of thumb, or not a guessing, but it's estimating a lot. So 10 and 90%, I think, can be identified easily on experimental data. So these 10 and 90% are connected to these lambda values due to this formula. So let's take one temperature, 1060 Kelvin. You can, based on the experimental data, you can get for this lambda this time and for this lambda this time. So now you have both points, okay? And you can, with respect to the formulas, calculate your exponential value and, of course, the relaxation time. Your tabular calculation program is one of your best friends if you want to do that. I think you can also do it with MATLAB or with scripting, but OpenOffice or Excel may help you a lot. So if you can do it for one temperature, you can do it for all the other ones. And this is, or what we see is, when you talk about this relaxation time with a stronger undercooling, so if we reach a lower temperature, then the reaction will receive an speed up, which is what we would expect. The austenite is, so to say, the high temperature phase for that alloy. And if we go beneath the austenite stable, beneath the stable austenite window, it will decompose. And the more we go beneath, the faster it will decompose. So this is something we may would have expected. And we can add, again, our equilibrium concentration. And then here, together with the temperature, you have the three parameters you need for LS-Dyna for this MAT254 available. You just need to put them in this defined table format, and then you're done. What you else can define based on MAT244, if you want, is the start and end temperature of the phase transformation. But please note, if your temperature is below PT end, the transformation will stop immediately. So if you choose a too high value for it, or an unphysical value, you will get nonsense. So it's some question how you define your process, and if there are more than one transformation occurring at the same time, how you distinguish them. This is not trivial to distinguish the different phase transformations if they occur at the same time and the same temperature. But in the 22 MMB5 and MAT 244, we have this hard borderline between these phase transformations, which can have this overlapping by this overbleeding. But for different problems, this may not be that trivial. We know that. So that was the direct approach. Let's go to the graphical approach. If we see these experimental data, we can again use our tabulation or table calculation program to plot these lambda versus ln tau or ln time. And if you remember this equation and see on these points, so now we have these points plotted versus the ln of time. I don't know how do you see it, but I think the left side or the bottom one of these points really describe a good linear equation. So let's take a look where were our lambda values chosen before. So for the direct approach, we choose values around these blue lines. So what we did with the direct approach is we draw a line from this point to this point and assume it to be linear. Well, comparing to this one, I would say that was not a bad assumption in this case, but this can be different in other cases. And then with this graphical approach, you have a chance to see how good your approach is. So for example, if you see that at a certain time, something different is happening, you see, okay, this is maybe not a good model for it. Okay, let's take a more detailed look. We will focus on the transformation till 90%. This is till the lambda 2 point. And we have these points which we use our approach on. And please note that each point represents one experiment. So in reality, you have done one experiment with a certain number of repetitions for statistics and scientific reasons. So maybe you have 8 repetitions for each point. So this is a huge number of experiments behind these data shown here. As LS-DYNA usually calculates the same if you have the same input, we skip that repetition point and just do it once. And but for these data for the 22 MMB5, the PhD work done in the past, they did all this effort. So this is not that simple like we show it here today. So what we now have to do for these points is we need to apply this function for the balance lines. And if you compare this equation with this balance line equation, you can directly take the values for n as value before the x, and this one for the ln k with this point. So to write it all together, we have, for example, for 1060 degrees, we have this point of ln k. We can calculate our relaxation time based on this identity. We can get this relaxation time for it, okay? And again, we can take the slope of the balance line with the n value. And what can be done for one line or for one temperature can be done for the other temperatures too. I will hurry it up a bit. So we then have the data and we can again add this equilibrium concentration. Of course, it does not change because they are independent from our approach. And then you have again all the data available you may need for LS-DYNA. And again, you may define this PT start, PT end. It's still the same because it's still the same experiment behind. So they did not change. But what is interesting now is to compare the results for the parameters of both approaches. I mean, both assume this linear connection. but then handle it in a different way. And what you can see here is they are different, yes, but they are similar. They are really close together. And from my experience in that field, I would say this is okay. So this is what you can also expect from real measurement data. And they are not that fixed, or they are difficult to measure, and therefore there is a large deviation often for many of these transformations in the literature. And you have to look which of the data fits to your case best, and then do also some experiments on your own. And also for the relaxation times, the values are at least in the same magnitude, and often in the same, really in the same range. So this is, yeah, quite good. But the difference can be explained that we do not have this exact linear connection. But it's close to a linear connection. So, yeah. So, and with these values, we can recalculate our experiment. And here you can see for three temperatures, the comparison between the experimental data, so 244 data with the Ökostrom approach, and the recalculated data with MAT 254, based on the results I have shown you some slides before. And you can see that they are really similar, or they are the same. And we did it for the ferrite and also for the perlite, but it was nearly the same, but with different numbers. And here you can see it for the perlite transformation, which is also the same. And yeah, that's how to get these data for these phase transformations. So this leads me to my summary. So what have we done today? So Thomas introduced the materials 244, which is tailored for hot stamping of 22 MMB5 and takes into account the real physical or metallurgical phases, austenite, ferrite, perlite, bainite, and martensite. It requires a chemical composition and is therefore maybe not valid for other alloys, because the formulas behind are very empirical, which restricts the applicability in terms of materials and processes. Your way out of this situation with LS-DYNA is the MAT 254, where you can tailor the material to your process, which is a big advantage. Unfortunately, you have to know what is going on inside your material, and this is a really tough task. So you need to know what is going on inside your material, what are the mechanisms, how they can be described, and then you can make use of it. Therefore, it is applicable to a wide range of materials. We used it for steel. We also had an approach on aluminum. And recently we did a lot of work on titanium with it. And of course, for various processes. Of course, press hardening, hot forming, welding, as well as 3D printing. 3D printing of metals is nearly the same like metallurgical, nearly the same like welding. You undergo the same temperature time profiles. So they can be, whenever we talk about welding, we also mean 3D printing as well. And of course, heat treatment. So with these materials, we discussed a blueprint how to identify parameters for the phase transformations based on the calculation of a relative reaction coordinate according to test data. The creation of the balance lines enables a trivial parameter identification. Usually it is much harder to get parameters. But these graphical balance lines also enables you to get a quality check of your chosen modeling approach. And it shows you it can show you the limits of your approach, because when you're leaving this linear range, you know, okay, your approach isn't valid anymore. But whenever you are on this linear approach or in this linear range, you can use it and trust it. And we apply it only to the austenite decomposition of austenite decomposition to ferrite of this 22 MeB5. So taking back this phase transformation table, we just talk about this entry. You can repeat it for the perlite, for the bainite, for the martensite, and if you want or need, also for the austenite composition. There can be further discussions, and depending on what you want to do with the material, you need to discuss which phases or pseudo phases you need to take into account. You may also need to discuss the resulting mechanical properties. Usually you want to know the yield strength or the yield curves of it. And you need to discuss how to apply it on your process, which limits you know, which limits you have. Whenever you can assume something, it will help you to fill in the data and to describe your process. So whenever you know this is my maximum temperature inside the process, this can help you to reduce the amount of knowledge you need to collect to describe it or to model it. As an outlook, I would like to show you this one. It was given on a crash conference. And here you can see this formula, which looks quite similar to the one I've shown you before. And they used this formula or this, they used this JMAC-like approach to describe the hardening degree of aluminum after the paint job and to scale the yield curves. And I think also the failure behavior of this aluminum based on this hardening degree or amount of precipitation which has already precipitated. And this is one example for this phenomenological approach. So you do not need to stick with that material to the metallurgical definition of a phase. This is where we came from with the material, but no one forbids you to define a pseudo phase or whatever. So you can tailor it for your use case, but therefore you need to know your use case quite well. And so I think that was a very good last sentence. With that, I would like to thank you for listening and for your attention. We kindly ask you to evaluate the session. So therefore, maybe Thomas, can you please copy the evaluation link inside the chat?
Yeah, I will. Give me a second.
Yeah, you can have two if you want. Please click on the link and evaluate the session and give us feedback. And also, if you have some special phase transformations in mind for your problems, just get in touch with us and we can discuss it together and how to implement it best, maybe. And yeah, please check also our homepage for the next webinars. I think today no new one was announced, but check it regularly to don't miss one of them. And I think if there are questions, we can discuss them if you want. So we can also unmute you if you want, but we can also, or you can just type it into the chat and then,
I can also write down my email address to the chat if you have asked any questions later on. Feel free to send me a mail. If you don't have it, so. So if there are no further questions, I'd like to thank you all for attending this seminar, for listening to what we had to say.
So with that, I would like to end this session. I thank you for attending and hopefully you can enjoy the weekend coming soon. And Take care and goodbye.